Well, thank you very much for the introduction, as well as the invitation to talk to all of you today. Well, first, before I start, all of you that are avid readers of abstracts, I hope you won't be too disappointed that I'm going slightly not quite the route that I said I would go. Turns out that my initial plan or scope of talk was a bit large, so instead, I will tell you basically all about my experiences with low-field NMR and all the nice things I got up to doing that. So the plan now is going to be that I'll give you a quick introduction into what SQUIDs and NMR is all about and how SQUIDs are used basically in low-field NMR. And then I'll just go on to tell you about the different probes I build, the different probes I use, different techniques we developed, and some interesting work we did on these sort of super paramagnetic nanoparticle samples as well. That'll just be a short aside, but well, we'll see how we get on. So I shall get on with it and go to my introduction. So, why SQUIDs for NMR? Well, they are very sensitive magnetometers, and they have the ones we've been using. They've got a noise floor that drops down to about femtotesla. So anything you want to look at that's basically going to be a small signal is going to be useful to use SQUIDs for looking at. So I mean, you can either think of it if you're going to do work in low magnetic fields where your sample polarization is going to be small just because of the field itself, then that's going to be useful. But also you might want to look at a scenario where you look at a sample that's just where you just don't have a lot of spins in it. You know, it could be maybe a subspecies in your sample or whatever. So both these cases, even maybe a combination of those cases, SQUID NMR can be quite useful for. I mean, compared to conventional NMR, we have a good advantage at lower fields because the SQUIDs actually detect magnetic flux directly, but our conventional inductive techniques, they measure the rate of change of magnetic flux. So as we go to lower fields, I mean, one is a quadratic behavior, but the other is linear. So we don't lose as much in sensitivity, as much in signal to noise ratio as with SQUID NMR as we would with conventional NMR. So there's also some other neat things. I mean, just generally having very, very low noise detector and nice wide signal bandwidth. So basically everything I'm going to be talking about is broadband detection. So you just have a loop, you pick everything up, and well, anything within its bandwidth, which is usually for our sensors up to about 6 megahertz. And which is mainly sufficient for doing anything in low fields. But so one nice review article that tells you all about why and how you can use SQUIDs for not just low-field NMR, but some other various applications as well is Greenberg's review paper from 98, if you want to look a bit more into it. He also kind of details how a lot of initial work in SQUID NMR was actually looking at cryogenic samples, so condensed metatype systems, helium, all that type of thing, because you have to have your detection scheme needs to be at cryogenic temperatures, so it makes sense to look at something that's right next to it, obviously in your cryostat or whatever. But you can there are ways of using your cryogenic detector scheme to actually look at room temperature samples, and that's what I'm going to talk about more today. A couple of different ways of doing it. So before we get to that, though, I'll talk about SQUIDs first. So, I'm not going to talk a lot about it, but I don't make squids, but I use them. So basically, your main principles are you've got a superconducting loop, and you have two Josephson junctions in it. So you're going to have your two main effects are going to be flux quantization, because the flux threading your loop wants to be a unit number. Well, do you say unit? An integer multiple of the flux quantum, and so that basically means that you're going to get an effect in your loop if it actually sits in a magnetic field that is not satisfying that condition. The loop itself will create a current that flows in it that will compensate for the non-integer field the non-integer flux quantum field it sits in. So this screening current is one important aspect of how a squid works. The other one is the Josephson effect. So you basically put two pieces of insulator in your loop, and you can, given certain conditions, you can tunnel some Cooper pairs through that. So it acts like a weak superconductor. Now, it's kind of important because it's the junctions that set your critical current, so the maximum current that can flow in the loop before the squid actually goes normal. So what we do, what is useful for us, is that if we actually bias our squid just above the critical current, we get this nice little range between. So the behavior is periodic, because when you have your screening currents flow, it will flow in one direction, obviously, to compensate for the field, but at some point it will switch directions, just because it's going to minimize the current it needs to have flowing in the loop to compensate for the field. So you get this kind of periodic behavior in terms of the critical current. This is why you have these two different branches here, where you have you have a different critical current, in essence, depending on what screening current is flowing. Because your maximum is if your screening current opposes the field, you can have more. Your maximum current's going to be your maximum critical current's going to be different. Okay, I'm confusing things. I think I'll just move on. But in any case, we get this periodic behavior if we bias our squid just above the critical current. It means that we can position ourselves. We can position ourselves in a spot where at a working point where basically for a given change in flux, we have a large change in voltage. So that's the message I'm trying to get across, in any case. Quick diving into pulsed NMR principles. Everything I'm going to talk about in terms of NMR is going to be pulsed. Now, just generally speaking, I'm not talking RF or anything. I'm just the main components of pulsed NMR are we're going to have some background field. So our sample is going to sit in some field. And that's our B0 field, so along our longitudinal direction. The strength of this field is going to determine how much magnetization you generate in your sample. So the lower the field, the lower your magnetization. If you have this as a starting off point, what you do in NMR is then you disturb the system. You knock it off equilibrium, and you see what it does, basically. So what it does do is it's gonna return to its equilibrium state. It's gonna realign itself with B naught, your overall magnetization. But before it does that, it will retain some coherent magnetization in your measurement plane, which is your transverse plane, if you say knock some part of it into this. You can then pick that up. So the things you do is if you measure basically your signal that you get in your measurement plane and how that decays, that tells you about the spin-spin relaxation time T2. And if you do something a little bit more complicated and look at how the magnetization grows grows back in along the applied external field, then that's your spin lattice relaxation time T1 that you can probe with that. So what you actually see is some kind of a periodic decaying signal. So if you imagine you've just knocked a little bit of this magnetization into the XY plane, what it will do is once it has no other perturbation, it will spin around your background field at the Larmor frequency, which is proportional to your field. And that's basically the frequency with which the frequency of your oscillations are at this Larmor frequency. And because the spins, they phase themselves intrinsically, but also due to maybe your whatever field they sit in otherwise, you're going to get this decaying behavior. Now, if you Fourier transform that, you're going to get the classic NMR line shape. And how wide that is, or how sharp, tells you how long or short your T2 is. So basically, the shorter your T2, the wider your line. So the shorter the T2, that means the more your spins dephase. So we'll get more into this type of stuff, I think, as we go through the talk. So SQUID-detected NMR. Now, there's a couple of particularities that we need to consider when we want to apply use SQUIDs in NMR. Now, so what we want is basically, as I kind of indicated before already, we want to sit at our like steepest working point, basically. So we essentially want a more or less linear amplifier. And we want magnetic flux into the SQUID, we want voltage out for it. The way we can do this is by a technique called flux-locked loop mode. So basically what we do is we use our SQUID as a null detector. We apply some feedback back into it via a feedback coil that the SQUID couples to as well to lock our V-phi into this one spot here. And whatever we need to compensate this with is what we use as our signal. Now we have one way of characterizing how good or how sensitive our SQUID is, because I'm saying yeah they're sensitive, but how sensitive they are in terms of NMR detection. That's where we talk about this quantity coupled energy sensitivity. Now, this is basically just proportional to the noise in your SQUID and the inductance of your input coil. And it's inversely proportional to your mutual inductance. So that means the stronger we couple to the SQUID, so the mutual inductance between the input coil and the SQUID, so the stronger we couple to it, the bigger this term becomes, the lower EC, epsilon C becomes. So the coupled energy sensitivity, the lower the better, basically. And our unit for that is H. So the fewer H we can detect, the better, the more sensitive. So it does logically depend on how low is our noise, how good is our coupling to signals rather than noise. Another thing actually we have to be careful with SQUIDs and NMR is that obviously NMR is pulsed. So whenever we excite our sample or system, we have to take care not to excite our squid too much. So there's a couple of parts that are that come into play in SQUID-detected NMR, one of which is superconducting shields. So we already have the squid sensor itself in a superconducting shield that basically shields it from most, like, just environment. But we also use in our NMR coil assembly, there'll be some superconducting shields used there as well to do various things that I'll probably go into later in a bit, more in a bit. Now, another thing we take care of is that we avoid trying to use one coil for excitation and pickup. So we actually have our receiver and transmitter coil. We'll try and make them as decoupled as possible so that we have as little crosstalk as we can. All of these things will help in our recovery time. So basically the time between doing a pulse and our ability to measure our NMR signal. But yeah, I'll get more into that. Yeah, Q spoil as well, reset mode, we'll get there. So now, low fields. Okay, so this is the more fun part for me anyway, now that I've got all this other stuff out of the way. So in low fields, basically, yeah, our magnetization is just not big enough to do anything with. I mean, even though squids are very sensitive, we just don't have enough polarization to see anything. So what we do is we pre-polarize our sample. So what we do is, I mean, if you ignore maybe all the horizontal lines here for a second, all we have is this sample sitting in a very small magnetic background field, which, yeah, if we try to do something like tip that into the measurement plane, wouldn't really give us anything. So what we do is we don't even begin to try that. And instead, we use a nice big DC pre-polarizing pulse that we apply in our measurement plane, straight in our measurement plane. So we get basically growth, we get some magnetization growth in our measurement plane that is actually completely independent of our background field. And it actually grows with the T1 of the pre-polarizing field. So once we've done that long enough and we have a nice enough signal amplitude, we switch this off non-adiabatically. So we just take it away, and then we observe the magnetization actually in the B0 environment. So whatever magnetization you just created is gonna just spin around B0 with the B0 Larmor frequency. So it's basically just, yeah, making getting us a signal and then doing what we would usually do, just observe that. So for us, we look at B0s that are sort of on the range of 100 nanotesla to 60 microtesla. So most of the work is done in a few kilohertz range, but I mean, just for fun, obviously you try to go down as low as you can. We do a lot of sweeping, so I'll get more into that in a sec. And yeah, so I kind of talked through all that already. I didn't realize. So okay, that was kind of the quick and dirty introduction. Some of this I'm gonna get back to and talk a bit more about as I talk about the actual system we use. So let's move on. Well, first I should say, the squids we use were made available to us from some while ago by means of a collaboration with PTB, a long-standing one between the Royal Holloway Low Temperature Group and them. But the ones I ended up using were what ended up being their commercial product at this point. So they use these squids that are two-stage squids, and I'll explain a bit about that in a second. The electronics we get from another company called Magnicon. It's kind of like an offshoot. So in a two-stage squid, what happens is that you have actually a single squid sensor. So why is that good? Well, if you have the single squid, you can actually couple to it better. So you get a bigger MI, you get a bigger mutual inductance, which is good. But the problem is that the single squid, obviously has a limited voltage swing. I mean, it only gives so much out. So, I mean, you can amplify that, but we kind of want our noise to be dominated by the squid noise, not some room temperature amplifier. So what we do is, well, we do what PTB does. They use an actual array of squids to couple to the signal from the sensing squid, which then amplifies our signal by so they say, yeah, the squid array behaves like a single squid with a large voltage signal. That's only really the case if they're all biased at the same working point and all this stuff. I mean, we used to work with squid arrays, just squid arrays at some point, and there's some subtleties involved there that that they don't always maybe work as optimally as you'd like. But here, I mean, here they work quite well. They're basically the same thing as the sensing squid, but they're not as tightly coupled to anything. So they really just work as an amplifier. Our coupled energy sensitivity that I mentioned before for these squids are around 50 H. So I think that's kind of cool. So the probe now. This was basically what we started off with. And this is a simple dipper probe. So we have a nice little cryostat, just full of helium bath, and we dunk this in there. Okay, maybe not quite as straightforward, because we want optimal field homogeneity. We actually put the probe in the bucket first. Since we have the duo we use has a mu metal can around it to shield out all extraneous fields, especially the Earth's magnetic field, because the fields we look at are around the Earth's field, so we need to get rid of that first before we can do anything else. So we put a probe in there, we transfer on top, everything goes superconducting in a nice gradient-free field. So sits there, it's good. So what is basically going on there is that we are looking at room temperature samples. As I said before, you can obviously just look at something like helium, but for us, we want to look at biological samples. Now, biological is a fancy way of saying water in our case, because it's just kind of a proof of principle type experiment at this point. Now, all our NMR coils are superconducting. So there's saddle coils, there's solenoids. As I mentioned before, we use these superconducting shields as well. So there's two of those. There's like the outer shield. Now, the outer shield basically tries to remove whatever's left here. So whatever the mu metal can doesn't shield, we have an additional shield. That will essentially, well, it kind of traps whatever is here when it goes superconducting. But it means that anything else that's anything fluctuating, maybe something higher frequency or whatever, will get screened out of the sample area. Now, the inner shield is quite important for squid recovery, because that screens the magnet former, which is copper, from the transmitter pulse, which is good, because if there was exposure of the copper former to the transmitter pulse, we'd get lots of eddy currents flowing, and that's all going to add to the squid not being able to hold lock. Because basically, your recovery time depends on is whether you've reached a regime where you're not exceeding the slew rate of the squid anymore. So, I mean, usually when we start taking data, there's still some big transient response, but it's just whether you've waited long enough for the squid to hold lock. Because if it doesn't hold lock, you get these flux jumps, and you can't average because your signals end up subtracting, and that's not so good. What else? So the probe is for looking at small room temperature samples. We make them room temperature inside the helium bath by means of just a resistive wire-wound heater, and I find it quite neat that it's only like the distance between 4 Kelvin and so the helium bath and our room temperature liquid water sample is less than a millimeter. So in terms of how we do the NMR, so the way we couple our signal to the SQUID is by means of a superconducting flux transformer. So we have to match our input inductance, so the inductance at the SQUID end that's fabricated on the chip, to the inductance of the pickup coil. So in the actual, well, I won't go into that, but in the actual SQUIDs, they have a double transformer scheme because they use the actual SQUID input inductance is a lot smaller than, I mean, they step it up to a better inductance for us to work with in terms of making a coil from. So the flux transformer is a really neat little thing. We've got a Q spoiler in that, and that's one of another one of these mechanisms of improving your recovery time. So basically the delay between pulsing and measuring. Because what it does is it's again an array of SQUIDs, but they're not shunted or anything. They just sit there. They can be hysteretic. It doesn't matter. The point is that if too much current flows in our loop, they will go normal, and they will go normal first a lot earlier than would otherwise go normal at, and so thus protect the SQUID from being exposed to too much current flowing in its input coil. So that's a Q spoiler. Now, yeah, I've talked a little bit about what coils we use here. It's not really that important. The other thing is we have a silicon diode basically in our sample space so that we can measure what temperature we're at. It's actually quite neat because we can really easily vary our sample temperature from 4K up all the way up to about 310 Kelvin. So it's a very neat and dirty little way of having nice temperature control. Right, so this spectrometer, we characterized it using, as I said, water. So the fun thing about going to lower fields is that because we polarize our sample with the same pre-polarizing pulse every time, it means our initial condition is the same every time. But so that basically means that our signal that we start off with is going to be it has the same area under the curve, but for a given relative magnet inhomogeneity, which is a constant parameter, as you go down in field, this inhomogeneity becomes less and less significant. So it means that I probably should have started with this, that when we measure a T2, so a decay of an NMR signal, we don't actually measure the spin relaxation time of the sample. It's straight in any case. It's really a combination of the magnet inhomogeneity factor and the intrinsic spin relaxation time. So there's additional local field fluctuations that are due to the magnet the magnet's field not being perfect. And for a given relative inhomogeneity in a magnet, that contribution goes down as you go down in field. So what happens for us is, if the area under the curve under your line width is under your line is the same, then as it becomes less and less broad because of a less and less magnet inhomogeneity adding to your signal, it also grows. So that's just to say that on this graph, as we go down in field, our signal goes up. This is kind of like a zoom, well, not a zoom, but it's a more it illustrates maybe better how different, a higher inhomogeneity signal for a given area would compare to a sharper signal at lower fields. So that's like 2 kilohertz. This is, incidentally, our lowest ever signal at around 4 hertz. So what we did is we basically measure this T2 star as a function of field. So we just all this is taking these points are just the amplitude of your signal after you've magnetized your sample. It isn't actually. I was lying. it's your it's to do with your signal width. But okay, never mind. The point is, I've actually plotted line width here. The point is that for us, this slope here is the magnet inhomogeneity. So if you extrapolate this to zero fields, then you've basically got your intrinsic T2 of water in this case. Now, for different polarities in our magnet, we have slightly different line widths, so that our zero field region is actually at a finite field rather than zero. There's always some field left over in the dewar, so you're going to trap some field in the superconducting shield. And it means that if you get to a point where the field in your magnets completely opposes that your trapped field, that's your zero field regime. So, all right, the other thing we did to characterize our spectrometer is we looked what else we could do with it, basically. So we looked at a sample with shorter relaxation times to see whether we could still see that. I mean, again, if you go shorter, how short your squid recovery time is matters. So this is basically just a check to see that the system's good enough to also measure things with shorter T2s. And we also did a two-component sample where in these two is we changed the temperature of the sample to just above zero, so that we basically froze out the water component, but we still saw some of the oil. So I mean, freezing out, it just means that the water when at that temperature, the T2 is just much, much shorter. So that meant for a given delay, or we did not really see the water component anymore. Again, as I said before, you get your zero crossing is your intrinsic T2. After testing that first one, that first prototype, so to speak, we tried to see whether we could actually, because it worked, but we couldn't really do anything that we wanted to do with it. So we were trying to see whether we could make it any better. So we needed a better signal to noise, really. And how do you improve your signal to noise? You either reduce the noise or increase the signal, right? We built a whole different probe, which was supposed to be an improvement on the original one, and it was. But the main thing we ran into trouble with was that because of our nice little compact superconducting shielding assembly, it meant that if we went to too high prepolarizing fields, we ended up trapping a whole lot of flux in our superconducting shield, which then completely ruined the homogeneity, the field homogeneity across our sample area. And that basically meant we had to warm up and cool the superconducting shields back down through their TC. So we were really limited by that. We did lots and lots of investigating into all sorts of easy things we could do with the system to maybe get BP a little higher, or prepolarizing fields, but really safely we could only go to up to about 4 millitesla. Our aim was always to get to somewhere near 20 millitesla, because then you can just look at many more things. But yeah, that wasn't really possible with the setup. So in any case, we took our factor 4 improvement in SNR and looked to see what we would do next. Before we moved on, though, we did a couple of other neat things. So I'm going to talk to you now about how you measure T1 in low fields. And this is definitely my very favorite part. So T2, I mean, is easy. You just polarize in the measurement field, and then you switch off the field and just measure your signal. T1 gets a little bit trickier because your fields that you're sitting in, your static applied fields, they're just too small, so they don't generate much polarization. But depending on your field region, there's different techniques you can apply to still measure T1. So, I mean, at high enough fields, a really easy thing you can do is just not leave your prepolarizing pulse on for long enough. So if you vary the length of your prepolarizing pulse and then just see what you get at the end of it, you can basically map out the T1 in the prepolarizing field. And you can change the prepolarizing field, you know, I mean, by just making it a bigger pulse or a smaller pulse. Of course, as I mentioned before, in this system where we did all this stuff in, we couldn't go too high without ruining homogeneity. In any case, that's the kind of straightforward regime. Now, the one below that, our intermediate fields regime, there we actually just used standard RF methods. So we did what you do in NMR. We sat in a field and we applied a resonant RF pulse of the right length to tip the spins at their Lamois frequency. But where it gets fun and interesting is in the low field regime and the ultra low field regime. And I'll talk probably at length-ish about that. Now, okay, so I already said about the prepolarizing one and the RF one. So just worth mentioning, we are RF T1s, we measured around 1450 kilohertz. That was just about as far up as we could go with our small little solenoid magnet. But so at low fields, we can do, I mean, what basically, both in low fields and ultra low fields, what we need to try and do is somehow get some magnetization into our Z direction, so along our field. So instead of tipping our equilibrium and watching it grow back to its equilibrium value, we now go the other way around. We put something in there that's bigger than what it usually would be and watch it decay. So for the low field regime, this is all arbitrary, we call it that, but so for our low field regime, what we can do is we do our usual stuff, we prepolarize in the measurement plane, but then instead of turning off the pulse non-adiabatically, we turn it off adiabatically. So what that means is as we just basically switch this field off slow enough so that the magnetization that we generated moves along with the effective field between B naught and BP. So all you need to do is just fulfill this adiabatic condition. And you can even switch off most of this quite quickly. And once you get to a regime where BP becomes comparable to B naught, that's when you really have to fulfill the adiabatic condition. But in any case, so from there on, we have this big non-equilibrium magnetization sitting along Z. And then we just wait some time tau, and then flip it back into the measurement plane for readout. And the way, actually, that's also kind of neat, at least to me, the way we tip it in this instance is we have some secondary DC polarizing field that is exactly equal to B naught, but just at 90 degrees. So what we end up with is an effective field that points at 45 degrees. And we end up tipping our the spins will start rotating around the effective field. So we basically do a 180 flip for them. And I mean, we just wait for the time with which it rotates its Lamo frequency is that of the effective field. So we just wait for 180 in that field, and there it is. We've got it in the measurement plane, and we measure it. So this is just us testing whether our adiabatic turnoff works. So the red line is what we're left with if we switch this pulse off slow, and the black is what we usually get if we just switch it off straight away. Okay, and now it gets even funner. So at some point, the times that you have to wait, basically the lower your B naught gets, the longer that adiabatic condition time becomes. So the slower the rate you really have to go at. So that doesn't really become workable anymore at a given field, because you end up having, you need rates that are slower than what your T2 is. So what we do then is something kind of funky. We again start, as we always do, by prepolarizing in the measurement plane. And then we do a non-adiabatic switch off, so that just stays there and it starts rotating around B naught. Now we only, because now, you know, at low fields, this the frequency of precession, the Lamo frequencies become quite slow. So it now becomes feasible for us to wait exactly a quarter of a revolution. And when that time's passed, what we do is we put on another smaller DC polarizing pulse. And now our magnetization, I mean, this polarizing pulse is still large compared to B naught. So now the magnetization sees that field and it starts processing around it. Now, again, we're in such low fields that even here, even though, I mean, it's shorter now because it's bigger than B naught. So B naught, this might have been a question of milliseconds that we needed to wait. This this polarizing pulse, it might be a matter of microseconds, but it's still all feasible to do. So we again wait for a quarter revolution with that Lamo frequency. And there we go, we've got a magnetization back along Z. So we do again, we wait for tau, and then we do the reverse of this method, just put the polarizing pulse back on, let it go into the measurement plane, and measure out. So, well, I quite like these. I know you probably don't get them when I just chat through them, but they're really kind of neat. So if you want to hear more about them, come and talk to me. I'll explain it all again. So what we did is we used these different techniques to do a quick scan of, like, measure T1 as a function of frequency in very low fields. And this is all measured directly in those fields. So what we did is we did it for two different temperatures. The black data is at a slightly lower temperature than what we would usually do. Red is more room temperature. And this is, yeah, just basically the T1 of water at frequencies ranging somewhere from, I think, 20 hertz to, that's probably, is that like 20 kilo, no, two, oh, okay, no, this must be prepolarizing stuff. Yeah, so millitesla's. Yeah, and these are just some of the pulse sequences we use. And you can see here, basically, this is that non-adiabatic turnoff pulse. So, you know, you can see that already there. We need to wait 100 milliseconds if we go much lower in B0, this just becomes quite long. All right, well, enough of T1. A quick one about the superperiodic nanoparticles, because that's a whole can of worms to get into. But I'll just quickly introduce you to what we looked at. This work was all done as part of a big EU collaboration we had, and most of the people in the collaboration were making different types of nanoparticles, functionalized ones, and all sorts for biomedical type applications. So our part in this was to evaluate. Because what they do is, like, some of these nanoparticles, they can be used for contrast in MRI, so standard MRI, and we were evaluating whether such nanoparticles would be suitable for doing something similar in low field MRI. So we had all these experimental nanoparticles that people from the collaboration gave us. Now, the disadvantage of that is that none of them were very well characterized, so analyzing what we got out of that proved a bit of a challenge. But before I show you some of the data, just quickly to tell you what we actually looked at. So magnetic nanoparticles, if you make them small enough, at some point they'll just have a single domain. And if they have enough, I guess, thermal energy, they can rearrange their if they have a single domain, they're like one big spin. And if they have enough thermal energy, then they can actually rearrange those spins in one go with some time scale that depends on temperature and your measurement time scale and all sorts. So, well, the point is really that if you have these nanoparticles in a suspension, then there's two mechanisms by which they can rearrange themselves. One is that they do just flip all their spins in unison, which is the Néel relaxation, or they can actually rotate the whole particle in the fluid, and that's then a Brownian mechanism, which is always going to be slower. But you can kind of see on this diagram here that if the dotted line here is your effective relaxation time scale, then the Néel really, because it's, I mean, the bigger you make your core, the higher the energy penalty that you need to pay to try and flip all the spins. So that's basically an exponential effect, and at some point around 15 nanometers for magnetite, you end up freezing this relaxation out, and Brownian starts taking over. But I mean, before the Néel flipping frequency is gigahertz. So, I mean, before you get to this type of size, the Néel is by far faster than Brownian, so that'll always dominate until you just get too big. Now, if you put these nanoparticles in a solution, what they do is they create extra local field fluctuations. So those extra field fluctuations and whatever spectral densities they provide to the protons diffusing around them, they will affect the protons. So if you do NMR on the water, or like on the protons surrounding such nanoparticles, what you'll see is that you get a quite shortened effective T2 time. So it kind of what we call relaxivity does scale with concentration. So the more nanoparticles you put in there, the shorter your T2 gets. Now, we did some measurements at room temperature just in a conventional little NMR magnet or NMR system even. And what we did there is, in order to measure the relaxivity, we basically just measured different concentrations and saw what T2 we got for them. in low fields, we just, because we couldn't really do that so easily, because it takes many reasons why it's not straightforward to just change samples and change concentrations and all that stuff. What we did there is we just basically measured a given concentration, so actually I think 0.6 millimolars here. We took that sample, put it in our dipper probe, and then measured the T2, so the line width, as a function of frequency, compared it to what we had if there was no nanoparticles in it. And there's definitely some effect going on there. So there was many, 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 many more measurements to this, but just to give you a flavor of some of the challenges we encountered, the first samples we got, when we put them in our dipper probe, it turned out that apparently there was hardly any relaxation. And we were measuring relaxation times that were close to basically the intrinsic of water, which was not what we were expecting. So it turned out that the sample cells we used, basically the nanoparticles all stuck to the walls. So that was no good. So we, instead of Steikast, we started using KLF. And they were happier with that. But we still had some, over a course of days, we basically lost relaxivity. So the relaxation times of the superperiometric solution would get closer and closer to that of water. So some really weird thing that we found out in the end was that the heater that we used to heat the sample somehow affected the nanoparticles, and this is not something that we ever really understood, but empirically what we found is that if we improved the filtering circuit of the heater so that its cutoff frequency was below 50 hertz, or well below 50 hertz, our sample became extremely stable. So yeah, I don't can't say what is going on there, but that's just something we measured. And there was all sorts of challenges like that the whole time we were measuring these nanoparticles. So in any case, the grand conclusion of all of this was that we needed a different system. I mean, while we were trying to put all these room temperature samples inside our helium bath, it had all these complications with it that weren't getting us really progressing. So we worked on a follow-up system where we could just, you know, we would have our SQUID and its coils all in the cryogenic environment, but then we would put our samples underneath the dewar in just a room temperature environment. So this is imaging through a low noise dewar that just holds your detection system. So I think this might be almost my last slide. So it's just a quick introduction to what this is. To make a dewar low noise, you try and avoid anything metallic, but you still need things like vapor shields and super insulation. Otherwise, you're not going to hold 4K liquids inside. Now, so what we do is we make the dewar from fiberglass. We can use a ceramic as a vapor shield, and you can use something that's kind of metallized in a way, but not conductive, such as aluminized polyester, which is what someone who has a patent on this type of design did. But we found that actually you could just crumple aluminized mylar, and the noise that generated was comparable to the polyester. So anyway, system, it does work, but we didn't get as far as building the supporting structure, so all the room temperature coils and stuff. This is the follow-up system. I mean, it only got so far, but it's a very popular student project every year. So there's always someone still working on it. obviously, not progressing that fast, but it's an entertaining little diversion in any case. Okay, so this is something I was going to go into a lot, but as I doubted myself, I've already run out of time. So it's good that it's just a quick overview of what some other people have done in the field of biodiagnostics. So, I mean, other groups have looked at things like using SQUIDs to this hasn't really gone past the phantom stage yet, but you can try and do some kind of imaging of neuronal currents. They have the fields generated by this type of a situation. I think you're talking like hertz, like 4, 5, 10 hertz signals, and very small ones as well. So this is the type of scenario, just as in multi-channel MEG and EEG, where you have a whole array, 3D array of SQUIDs, and you try and basically pinpoint where you have neurons firing and all sorts of things like that. I mean, that's a whole different science, but it's interesting in any case. And for like the type of system we were trying to build, other groups have built similar systems, and they've done stuff like explosive screening and doing some cancer screening, even just doing NMR, because you have cancerous cells have different T2s than healthy tissue. So you can show that even in low fields you can image, you have good enough imaging capabilities to screen for, I think it was prostate cancer that John Clark screened, and people like Hugh who patented this low noise dewar, he imaged peppers through Coke cans and all sorts of things like that, because obviously in a high field MRI scanner you can't do you can't have metal inside, because that'll throw all sorts of things off. I don't think I really have a conclusion. This would have been an even bigger tangent into what else you can do with SQUID NMR, and basically what we at Royal Holloway these days do with SQUID NMR. But I'm saving you from that, and I don't think there is a summary. So thank you for your attention, if you managed.